Have you ever heard of the word Bildungsroman? Neither have I, but on Wikipedia it says that it's a German word for a literary genre that focuses on the psychological and moral growth of the protagonist from youth to adulthood. In English, we know it as a coming-of-age story, and there are plenty of coming-of-age films too, like this, or that, and that, but if you notice, these films are Hollywood. They offer a mostly white, narrow perspective of what it means to grow up. These characters deal with first world problems like detention or baseball. So what about the other coming of age films? You know, the ones that aren't about rich suburban white kids? There are many, but none are as celebrated and as studied as Spike Lee's 1994 classic, Crooklyn. Crooklyn follows the story of Troy Carmichael as she grows up in Fort Greene, Brooklyn. Being the only daughter of five siblings, Troy fights to gain the respect of her brothers, her parents, and her community. Troy's family struggles to make ends meet, eventually leading to a climax in which Troy's mother dies of cancer, forcing Troy to grow up and take over her mother's responsibilities. Crooklyn is Spike Lee's seventh film, released in 1994. It's rated PG-13, which is one of the only Spike Lee films to be rated as such, the other one being Malcolm X, which came out the year before. And while Malcolm X is now considered a landmark film, at the time it was met with mixed reviews. So at this point, after Malcolm X, Spike Lee wanted to make something more personal, more approachable, and less political.
As far as my career goes and the types of films I want to make, that it was important to do something different and not duplicate what we did with Malcolm X or the other two films dealing with race.
Right. Jungle Fever.
Jungle Fever and Do the Right Thing you know, race stuff between black people, you know, school days. I just felt it was time to change the pace.
And that's where Spike Lee's siblings come in. So
my sister Jwa Lee, stand up, please. My little brother Sankey Lee, right here. So they had written this script called Hot Peas and Butter, and it's about the Lee family growing up in Fort Greene, the Republic of Brooklyn.
They had written it without even telling me, and I liked it. Just some of the stuff is semi-autobiographical in the film. So
this makes Crooklyn unique. It's a black American coming-of-age film, but also a love letter to Spike Lee's childhood, to Fort Greene, Brooklyn, and to Lee's mother, Jacqueline, in sickness and in health. But this is Spike Lee we're talking about here. As heartfelt and family-friendly as he's gonna get in Crooklyn, he still maintains his signature style.
Well, you ain't nothing but a damn Puerto Rican.
Including his style of cultural references to emphasize time and place. And these references often evolved into direct inspiration from other films Spike Lee likes, which is evident in Crooklyn. I see Stand By Me, I see The Bicycle Thief, I see Peixote. With Peixote, Spike Lee takes a lot of inspiration from Hector Babenco and his on-location directorial style. In a BBC interview, Lee cites Peixote as being one of his favorite films because it just shows you this whole other world of kids trying to survive in the ghettos of Brazil. Spike Lee attempts to do the same with his own world of 1970s Fort Greene, but instead of focusing on a black community ravaged by poverty, he shows that despite what white America thinks, there's at least one family in Hollywood this year where both parents are there, where the mother's not on crack, walk in the corner, where the family's not on welfare, the sons aren't rapists and muggers, and the daughters aren't out getting pregnant at the age of 8. And it's a normal family who fight and fuss and love, but they're not dysfunctional. So I think the basic themes of these films are similar. Both groups of kids are unashamed products of their community, so much so that in Crooklyn, Troy's neighborhood of Fort Greene is more than just a location. It becomes a character, in and of itself, just like in Peixote. Babenco's on-location filming makes Sao Paulo a living, breathing entity. And capturing these entities honestly means filling them with the people that actually live there, like in The Bicycle Thief. The people that are casted in that film are not Hollywood actors all glammed up, but are regular Italian people that actually live in Rome. I think this had a lot of influence on Spike Lee's decision to cast Zelda Harris instead of a professional actor. This casting choice gives Crooklyn a neo-realist feel, much like The Bicycle Thief. The on-screen characters feel more real because the people playing them look real. They don't look like they've been sitting in a makeup chair for hours.
So the kids is always that's always crucial, and I tend to like actors who aren't child actors. So we went to a lot of public schools and stuff like that.
But all this to say, like, who really cares about the characters if nothing happens to them? What happens if they don't struggle with any meaningful kind of conflict? I think that's where coming-of-age films like The Breakfast Club fail. The characters don't change through action, but through expositional dialogue.
Do you know how popular I am? I'm so popular. Everybody loves me so much at this school.
Poor baby.
Contrast that with a coming-of-age film like Stand By Me. Here we have a group of kids who go out on an adventure to find a dead body, but when they eventually do find it, they realize the grim and mature reality of death.
The train had knocked Ray Brower out of his keds, just like it had knocked the life out of his body.
Jesus.
The kid wasn't sick. The kid wasn't sleeping. The kid was dead.
And this conflicting moment gives the main character a chance to finally process the death of his own brother, changing him for the better. That's way more compelling than A Day in Detention. So I think Spike Lee wanted to emulate that kind of character structure with Troy, especially since her character struggles with the death of her mother. We witness Troy go from one of the boys to the sole maternal figure of the family, and it's not like she had any choice in any of it. Another aspect of Stand By Me which is seen in Crooklyn is the use of period music. To some degree, both of these films are memory movies. They celebrate a time and place which can never be experienced a second time.
It's Bobby Day with Rockin' Robin. It's Boss.
Stand By Me perfectly sets the mood of the 1950s through its soundtrack, just like Crooklyn does, but with the music of the 1970s.
Oh, shut up and just get in the room.
We gotta live together.
Music is always, I've found, to be the easiest thing to get a sense of the time period.
All of this is to say that Spike Lee's Crooklyn is at this point a certified cult classic. And while it didn't get the kind of acclaim Do the Right Thing got, it certainly cemented itself over the years as a landmark film not only for New Yorkers, but for all young black Americans. As a result, Crooklyn won the One Film, One New York contest in 2015, forever proving that Crooklyn is a staple of American filmmaking.
And the winner is Crooklyn! The Mayor's Office of Media Entertainment and the New York Times have planned free screenings of Crooklyn in outdoor parks and indoor movie theaters in all of the five boroughs this September 13th. See you at the movies.